Good morning.
Good morning.
God of kings, God of glory, grant us courage, grant us wisdom for the facing of this hour. Let's stand and sing. Because of the virus, we're not going to pass the plates. I know that sounds like some other denomination than a Baptist denomination, but we're not going to pass the plates. But back there in the back, you can put that your money in the plate on the way out. And also, we're not going to have the fellowship time where we stand up and turn around and shake one another's hands because of the virus as well. I want to encourage you, though, to stay connected to one another. If someone is not here, it'd be okay if you got on the phone and gave them a call and said, "Hey, I missed you. You've been going to the other service, just haven't seen you. Are you okay?" Miss Joyce has done the prayer list that we usually give out on Wednesday night. She has redone that and put it back there in the back. That is an ongoing thing to keep that thing current and right. Some people are sick and they get well, and other people are sick and they get worse. And so that's an ongoing thing. Her phone number is on there so you can give her a call so she can keep that kind of updated for us. We have some things we need to pray about. First of all, we have a praise. Miss Mandy Mann is going to have another grand baby girl. So I'm going to call her a grand girl, okay? And I'm not sure when that will be, but it'll be soon. And so we're congratulating her. That announcement's in the bulletin. You can give her a call or send her a text and say congratulations to her. She's out of town, I think, this weekend. Got a call from Michael Beck. This week, Michael Beck had his test on his back leg and is facing surgery before long. Everything went well for the test, but he's still in a lot of pain and still needs our prayers. So remember Mr. Michael Beck. Rachel Ray's father, this is not Rachel, this is my brother's wife's father. He has had multiple strokes this week. So I told you last week that her mother is in Florence Rehab, but now this is her father. So both of her parents now are very sick. So pray for Miss Rachel. She is doing the best she can. This is Henry and Dorothy Smith. Henry's a music minister, I think, at Calvary Baptist out this way. Don't quote me on that, but I believe it's at Calvary Baptist. So remember to pray for him. Faye Bishop's surgery has been put off to July the 22nd. That's in the prayer list. Lily Pugh's daughter has had another stroke. We mentioned that last week, but we need to continue to pray for her. And then finally, Miss Peggy asked just a moment ago that we pray for one of her friends. His name is James Allen Smith. He has also had a stroke. Last but not least, you were here today, brought here in the big picture by the will of the Almighty. Here we are together. And the Bible teaches us where two or three are gathered in His name, He is there. The frustrating thing, I think, for some of us sometimes as Christian people is that even though He's here, we don't see Him, we sometimes don't feel Him, we don't hear what He has for us. So what we want to do as we get started this morning is kind of prepare our hearts to hear from Him. It really doesn't matter if you hear from Brother Jerry, sorry. I'm sorry, David, it really doesn't matter if you hear from Brother David, but what really does matter is if you hear from God. So we want that to happen this morning, and obviously that's up to him, but it's also up to us in that our ears can become very used to not hearing from him. There's so many voices in the world in which we live that we get used to listening to those voices instead of listening to his voice. So at least once or twice a week, you just tune in at worship time especially and listen for his voice. Join me in prayer. Father, we pray for special grace to us today. We ask God that you cut through whatever confusion is in our hearts and minds. Our emotions can cloud our listening. Our minds can cloud our listening. Father, the circumstances that we're under, be it virus or sickness or whatever else it might be, that can cloud our hearing as well. So we pray, Lord, that you would bless us and help us to hear from you. We ask, God, for your special grace for us this morning in our respective needs. There's a good crowd of us here this morning, which means there's a good crowd of needs that are here. There are a good crowd of people who are still a little afraid to come, and pray that you bless them even though they're not here. We ask, God, that you keep us all safe and well and healthy in serving you. Give us clear vision about what that would be and a heart with a will to do it in Jesus' name.
Well, as we approach worship this morning, we continue to be in prayer and troubled over events in our country. For one reason or another, things seem to be going awry. And when we come to places like that in history, frequently the churches have responded by saying, well, we need to get back to basics. You remember that phrase, back to basics? Well, you know, there's a simple children's song that kind of leads us in that direction. And the most basic thing that we can say is that regardless of what the world is telling us, Jesus loves the world.
Amen.
Jesus loves us. Jesus loves me and you. As we worship together, let's prepare our hearts with that simple but profound truth in mind. Let's stand and sing together.
Jesus loves me this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. Pray I weep, but he is strong. There is peace, I trust in him.
Of course, today is Father's Day. I offer my welcome along with Brother Jarius to all those who are visiting family and relatives today in celebration of that secular event, but it does certainly have pertinence and perhaps origins in our faith, because the faith of our fathers has manifested itself in many ways through the years and through the centuries. Of course, modeling virtuous life in many ways, his fatherhood, but also encountering and endeavoring to be fervent in one's evangelism, and certainly dedication to faith, even in persecution. And as this hymn points out, even to the point of martyrdom, faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. Hymn number 279, let's sing together.
looked away. Many times I could not pray. Still in love, you proved faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly, reaching out for what pleased me. Still in love, you proved faithful to me. Every time I come back to Him, He is waiting with open arms.
South Dakota or North Dakota. It's one of the Dakotas up there. I know that. But it is South Dakota, and we're glad that you're here. We're glad you brought your husband with you. If I'd known he was coming, you could have preached today. How about that?
He's on vacation.
He's on vacation. They have started a church there and doing well. And we're really pleased to have them, and probably need to put you on up on the prayer list about the work there and the ministry there. So we're very pleased for the whole Bertram family in that. We begin a new series next week on self-confidence. I have toyed with this for quite some time now, probably 6 or 8 months. Didn't know exactly whether to do this or not. In some ways, you think, well, we need to be confident in God and not in us. And I think that's true in so many different ways. But at the same time, I think God provides for all of our needs. And your emotional needs, your emotional person is just as important, I believe, as your physical person is. You can be physically alive, emotionally be kind of out of sync with perhaps what God wants to do in your life. So we'll begin this next week, and I would encourage you to come. I think that a lot of people, I've been a pastor for quite some time now, and I think a lot of people that I talk to in the various churches that I've been a part of have a self-confidence problem. They don't really believe in themselves, or self-esteem and self-confidence are two different things, and we'll talk about all these things, and obviously this is going to be on the web when we get it done, but at the same time, it's nothing like being here yourself, so come and be a part of that. I believe God cares about your confidence level. I believe He wants you to feel confident in yourself. So, having said that, I almost forgot this. Next week, we're going to be on the same, let me just run around here. We're going to be the same schedule that we were this week and the week before. That is, we'll have services on Sunday morning, but not Sunday evening. If I confused you last week, it's Donnie's fault. Donnie wasn't here, so I'm going to blame that on Donnie about the scheduling for last week. It is good to have the Overton's, the Clonches back with us. Sorry. Here's the schedule. I'm somebody special this next week, and then we'll just move right straight through it. So having said all that, we're going to talk about fathers and fatherhood. I have my own struggles with being a father and feeling good about having been a father. I do believe, I have two daughters and a granddaughter right back there. I do believe that if I had to do it all over again, I'd do better the next time. But there's some things you don't get a do-over with. You know, when your children are small, you're really learning how to be a father, you're learning how to be a mother, and sometimes we don't find many models for a lot of things in life. For example, I heard a pastor say once that we have an unholy tradition in the Baptist church. Nobody witnesses. Mama didn't witness. Grandmama, granddaddy didn't witness. They never wanted anybody to Jesus, so we don't feel like we have to. We never saw that model. It wasn't talked about much there. So fatherhood is similar, I suppose. And there's some ways in which this sermon, I'm reminded of that old saying that we used to use, fools rush in where angels fear to tread. I'm a fool. I'm about to rush in, okay? And part of me, in my mind, there's a little voice that says, people are going to be a little bit critical about certain aspects of the message. But the best part of me says, I'm not trying to serve those people. I'm trying to serve the Lord. And the Lord can, if I please the Lord, that's the place that I want to please there. So, having said that, our scripture is Romans 8, verses 14 through 17. You see it on the PowerPoint there. And the reason that we're reading this is because I want you to see that this whole relationship of fatherhood, sonship, and all those kinds of things, and the word Abba, which means father, it's not just, we don't just get it from Jesus. Obviously, he taught us to pray our Father which art in heaven. For the record, Jesus, when he addressed his Father, God, he never addressed him as God but once. And that's when he said, my God, where art thou? The rest of the time, he addressed his dad as Father. So he taught us to look at God the Father as a Father. And that imagery or that analogy is good. That analogy is all through the New Testament, especially in the Gospels. Are you at Romans 8? If you are, stand up. If you're not at Romans 8, pretend that you are, and no one will ever know. Amen? I'm reading from the New International Version. I'm going to be referencing the King James as we go forward, but this is what it says, beginning with verse 14. Because those who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you receive the spirit of sonship, and by him we cry, that is him being the Holy Spirit, we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. He's the Father, we're the children. Now, if we're children, then we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. That makes Jesus our brother, he's the older brother. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. Just an excerpt from Romans chapter 8 to kind of get you thinking about the idea or the analogy of fatherhood, God being our Father. And Father, we praise you for what you've done for us in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for this great honor that you've given us guys, many of us, to be able to be fathers. Not everybody gets to be a father. We praise you, God, for allowing us this privilege. We pray, God, for your grace and this very practical part of life, a very key part of life in the world in which we live today. In Jesus' name, amen. So we want to start out this morning by talking about some fatherhood realities. We want to consider some things, and I've just listed four here for us to think about as we go forward. We want to think about absentee fathers. Most of the time when we go through Father's Day, and the preacher preaches on Father's Day, and talk about all those guys who are in prison, and they do surveys, the folks that are in prison, and the majority of them, the vast majority of them, had absentee fathers. That doesn't mean that the Father wasn't there. It means that the Father perhaps was not engaged or was away or didn't take his fatherhood responsibilities seriously. Now, I didn't do the diligence on the sermon to look up the statistics on that, but you can. I mean, this is, it's amazing how much influence that the father has on the kids, and especially these prisoners who wind up in prison. And then we have the animal of a father who has poor fatherhood skills. You know, you can be a good person when it comes to doing things around the house. You can be a good fixer of things. You know, fathers fix everything, don't we? We are kind of geared that way. We like to fix things, fix the car, fix the house, fix the lawn, you know, we fix things. You can have all those, but maybe poor fatherhood skills. And perhaps your father had poor fatherhood skills. I mean, they may be a good person, but have poor skills as a father. And you can be, and if I could just throw this in here, going forward, and you can disagree with me if you'd like to. Like I said, I'm not preaching for you, I'm preaching for somebody else. You can be a good father and your kids turn out bad. In the Garden of Eden, here's a great example for you. In the Garden of Eden, you know, they had everything perfect and they turned out bad. Because the kids have free will just like the father has free will and the mother has free will. There's a heritage that we talk about on a regular basis. We call it legacy or heritage. And of all the things that you're going to leave behind, and you're going to leave behind a lot of things, you want to leave behind this thing of being a good father and helping your kids grow up. You have the most influence, obviously, on your kids' kids, and then your grandkids obviously have some influence on as well, and sometimes we're pressed to be fathers to our grandchildren. But first and foremost, I think, is the kids. Now, we want to leave a good legacy for our children in this area. You can leave a lot of money and not leave them a good fatherhood legacy. We have fathers who are partial to the other siblings or the other things in life. Jacob and Esau's great example of twin boys who one of them was favored by their mother. Jacob. And then Esau was favored by his father. And so we have that problem there. And then sometimes, here's another issue that has occurred to me as I've grown a little bit older, and that is the playing field changes all the time. What is fatherhood? Fatherhood today is seen as something different than fatherhood in the 40s, and fatherhood even in the 70s. I graduated from high school in 1972, and my father and his generation were different fathers than once been required of us. You could be a good dad in 2020, that doesn't mean you're a good dad in the 1940s. You know, things change in the playing field, not what's required out of us, but in the playing field itself. That influences all of us. Dads have a dilemma. Wives sometimes tell us, ladies don't throw anything. Wives sometimes tell us what good fathering is. If you were a good father, you would do. Don't say amen, guys. If you were a good father, you would do. They have an idea of what good fathering is, but dads have that idea as well. The culture that we live in tells us what a good father is. There's a show on television now called Council of Dads. I don't recommend it. I'm just referencing it there. Because they are telling you what a good father is by the culture standards. And when I say the culture standards, I mean the 2020 cultural standards. And the standards of 2019 were probably different than they are today. I really believe, and this is just my personal conviction, we have very few good examples of fatherhood. Very few good examples. Our values change, our expectations have changed about what we expect out of dads. You know, used to be you didn't expect your dad to go to the ball game. Now, if your kid's in the ball game, dads need to be there. You know, it's kind of expected that they be there. Used to be, dads were not expected to do much around the house. No cleaning, no cooking. Amen? Excuse me. I'm just making the point. Now, you know, just virtually every young couple that I talk to and I ask them about, you know, who's going to cook, who's going to clean up, everybody expects everybody to do things. And I think that's probably a good change. But some of our expectations are unrealistic. And some of our expectations are not. Dad duties change over the years. And so I'm trying to confuse the issue. Am I confusing the issue? Good, good. We live in a broken world. Sin came into this world and broke it for good. And then sin traveled to sin, traveled to sin, traveled to sin. And now we're living in a mess. Can I say it in Alabama language? We're living in a mess. And in the middle of that mess are fathers. If the world is broken, the fathers are broken as well. And that's the reason you see all that you do sometimes on television. Sometimes a good woman marries a bad man. Sometimes a good man marries a bad woman. So it gets to be broken in that way as well. So let's just say, for the sake of considering it, let's just say you had a bad day. What are you going to do? You going to live with that? Are you going to get over that? Somehow or another, get over that. Are you going to just put up with that, struggle with that for the rest of your life? I hope not. I hope not. I want to ask the question, though, where's dad? As dads go, so many times they're just not there in terms of being engaged. And I do believe that the Bible teaches that we should be engaged. You look at the landscape of dads, the landscape is kind of quiet. You know, my wife and I, last Sunday afternoon, did a little brainstorming about this sermon. Believe it or not, I listened to my wife. Not much, but I listened to her. She's probably watching on television right now. I shouldn't have said that, should I? But we were talking about good dads. Who's a good dad? Who's not a good dad, et cetera. We have our opinions, of course, but it's very complicated, isn't it? If you have a bad dad, you may be, for the rest of your life, looking for that father image that you lost or never had somewhere down the way. There are moms who are asked to become dads because dads are not there, won't be there. Single parenting is just a fact of life now. But in the middle of all that, sometimes no dad becomes normal. Think about it. This is one of those sermons I want to muse over. It gets even more complicated because in the Bible, we're taught that dad should be the spiritual leader of the home. And if there's no dad there, that home is spiritually leaderless. No, mom picks up the slack. Obviously, moms do a fantastic job, that kind of thing. But dad's supposed to be the spiritual leader. Now, I want you to cut this real thin here. Dad's not the head of the home. Jesus is the head of the home. Dad's the leader, the spiritual leader of the home. It's just like the preacher is not the head of the church. Jesus is the head of the church. But the preacher is the spiritual leader, at least for whatever time that the Lord puts him in that particular place. Dads need to be the kind of dad that the wives or moms can lean on. And I will say it this way before we press on to point number two. Now, all this is point number one. For the record, I got a clock right back there, okay? But dads have a profound impact, a profound influence, not only on the home, but on the culture in which we live. They are a key. They are a forgotten key. They are perhaps a lost key or perhaps a missing key, but they are a key. That brings us to our Heavenly Father. If we could leave the realities of fathers and go to our Heavenly Father for just a moment. Sometimes we have to bypass our earthly fathers and look for another father. David Cumby is a good friend of mine, used to be a deacon at Woodmont Baptist Church. If I know him, he probably still is a deacon at Woodmont Baptist Church. He had the terrible tragedy of having lost his mother and father in one automobile accident when he was young. I think around middle school age. They were both killed in a car wreck, so he went to live with his uncle and his aunt raised him the rest of his life. He said that Psalms 68:5, don't look there, I'll tell you what it says. It says that God is a father to the fatherless. He said that scripture became his favorite scripture in the whole of the Bible because he had a really good father and a really good mother, and he lost them both in one fell swoop. God can become a father to the fatherless. Sometimes it's necessary in this whole process to forgive and move on. We think about this. And I want you to think about this as you consider your own dad. Your dad may be gone. If you had been in his situation, what would you have done? And with his raising, You know, he raised probably like he was raised. That's our default setting as fathers, as we do what we've seen done. For the record, that's not necessarily a good thing to do, but that's what we do. So don't judge until you walk the mile in that person's shoes, because we don't know what we would have done. But I will ask you this, how long are you going to hurt? Are you going to carry this pain that perhaps you have because your father was either not there or not a good father? You're going to carry that until you die? Well, you can and you will, I believe, unless you do something about it. So I'll suggest a focus on fathering. The importance of father, one of the reasons I'm preaching this message, not just because it's Father's Day, because I think this is a big old open landscape that we have missed somehow or another. It's more important, being a father is more important than what you can fix. I can fix the car. Well, good for you. I can't. That's the reason those mechanics are doing real well. It's because I can't fix the car. But I think if you have to weigh those two things, you got it. Which is more important, be a father or fix the car? It's more important to be a father. I'm a good lawn person. Well, fantastic. But more important than whether or not the lawn looks good is what you do as a father. Isn't that true? Okay. We need to focus on fathering because it's so relevant and because it is such a lost key. What an honor has been bestowed on us, those of us who are dads, to be allowed by Almighty God to be somebody's dad. If you ever get this privilege, you need to consider that as a privilege. So that's the Heavenly Father thing. My forever status, my forever family, I'm a son of the Almighty. Romans 8 taught us that just a second ago. It's just right on the surface. You know, some of the truths of the Bible are deep. You have to dig for them, but that one's not. It's right on the surface. Before you were saved, you were a slave to sin. Then you became a servant and a son, all basically at the same time. Servanthood is more, most of the time, it's more the way we look at what we're doing. We're a servant of the Lord. But it says here, very plain English, that we're sons in God's family. A son has the opportunity to own property, inheritance, versus a servant. A servant doesn't necessarily inherit all those things. A son is an exalted status in that when the dad dies, the son starts telling people what to do. They are in authority place. And then the son has the opportunity to be disciplined. It's an advantage to be disciplined. You don't discipline the servants basically in the same way. So it's that same thing. It's an elevated role there. Fatherhood implies relationship. You can't be a father without being in a relationship with someone down the line. Relationship with God on the spiritual realm, relationship with your own kids on the regular physical realm. Fatherhood includes responsibility. Responsibilities for things like housework. A responsibility to your mom. A responsibility to your job. But also, and more importantly for our look this morning, the responsibility to our own children. I don't think, I'm 65, I don't think my fathering has stopped. My kids, you know, I breathed a sigh of relief when I got them through high school. They're alive. That was my fault. Success for me was just getting them through high school alive. Because, you know, I saw some of the things they did, and I wondered if they was going to kill themselves or somebody else in the process. And they lived. But since then, I've decided that fatherhood is not necessarily just getting them through alive, and it goes on beyond. Our practice, though, and this is important, this may be the most important thing I say this morning. Our practice is to look around the landscape, see how other people are fathering, and say, okay, I'm doing this, I'm doing this, I'm doing this. It's kind of like churches. We look around the other churches and say, well, we want to do this, we need to do this. Might be right, might not be right. It's like looking around and seeing what other people's clothing styles are, or other dads, in this case here. That's wrong. What we need to do is look at God's word for a biblical pattern of some kind. And sometimes the Bible is very specific about what it says that we're to do. And sometimes the truth that's there is inferred truth. And sometimes The truth is there, it's just generally taught there. So that's what we're going to do here in just a moment. I will say this before we leave this. It's totally irrelevant for me to look at other dads and say, I'm better than that one, I'm better than this one. What's relevant for me is to say, God, how am I supposed to father in these circumstances, at these times with these people? That is not, the place where my children are is going to change. They're going to get to be adults if they live long enough there. The pattern of the Bible is this. There are good dads and bad dads in the Bible. Jacob and Esau, we referenced them just a moment ago. Their father was Isaac. They had twins. Isaac favored Esau. Rebekah favored Jacob. And you know how that worked out. Didn't work out so grand. They were not the best parents in the world, both the mother and the father there. So what we want to do is look at some positive principles here, see a positive pattern in Scripture. Now, I use the word pattern intentionally because they're guidelines. Now, let me just throw this out at you for you to think about it again. There are a lot of single moms in this world. In fact, think about how many single moms there are. And that fact and that area is growing. So, you know, it's a guideline or a pattern that we find in Scripture. Jesus addressed God as Father. We'll start right there. He is a father to the fatherless. He is a loving father. He's strong enough, God the Father, is strong enough on the one hand and kind enough on the other hand. There. He became the father that perhaps you've always wanted or can be, but you never had. God the Father. I'm recommending that to you. Let God be your father. And what that means, bottom line, if you go quickly, the bottom line is, when you learn to trust him, you're not just trusting God, you're trusting your dad. Because he's your father, right? Then there's a Bible, has patterns as well, Bible pattern. God's the Father, he is the ultimate pattern, right? God the Father is the ultimate pattern. He is always there. He's always holy, always. He's loving on the other end, always. He's giving on the other end as well. He's just always there. He is the perfect, perfect father. That's the general way of looking at fathers and this whole. So he sets a kind of a pattern for us. More specifically, moms and dads are together. And I'm thinking right now, we haven't gone there yet, but I'm thinking of Ephesians 5 and Ephesians 6, if you want to reference this when you get home. In the Bible, moms and dads are together. That's not always the case in the, quote, real world. You have single moms, you have dads who are single dads, and that kind of thing, and it works out on a regular basis. But you have that guideline there, moms and dads together. And when God started the family, he started it with a mom and a dad, raising kids. From the beginning, there were those two parents there. A lot of times on television, you know, you don't have the two parents. I just think I'll have a kid. Well, you know, the pattern, the best pattern, not, you know, none of us live a perfect life, but the best pattern is to have a mom and dad. That's best there. So moving forward, and the Bible also teaches in Ephesians 5 that the dads should love the moms. Period. If you want to do something for your children, love their mom. I think probably that's one of the biggest things you can do to influence and have a positive home is to love the mom. Kids can tell that if you love the mom. It gives stability to the home. It gives love to the home. The kids grow up in a love atmosphere there. You are setting up a pattern for them, a pattern of parenting there. Before you can have parenting, Ephesians 6, you have father and mother, Ephesians 5 there. Let me illustrate some things to you. I don't want to be hurtful, but I just want to say this. It's more important that you love their mom than it is that you give your kids a swimming pool. Can I say it that way? Oh, I wish my kids had a swimming pool. I've heard this literally over the years. I've heard, if I had been a good father, I would have given my kids a swimming pool. And in the back of my mind, something goes, You know, that's just wrong. Isn't it? That's just wrong. It's more important that you love their mom. If you can love their mom, that'll help you to be a better dad. It'll help mom to be a better mom. Obviously, but Mother's Day's already passed. We miss Mother's Day. We'll go back and do Mother's Day one of these days. So here's what you got. You got God as the ultimate model. You have mom and dad together, two people. That's best. It's not, it doesn't happen every time. But that's best, and that's what the scripture gives us. It gives us best, doesn't it? This is what we're shooting for here. And then in the home, the dads, there needs to be no doubt about whether or not dad and mom love each other. If you have to work on that, you have to work on that. Join the human race if you work on that one right there. And then the last is Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. And Deborah, I want you to put that scripture up there if you don't mind. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. Well, you don't have to look this one up. All this in the last point here has to do with Ephesians 5 and 6. Ephesians 6, 4. This is from the International Version here. Look at what it says. Very common scripture. I think you may remember from the King James Version versus the New International Version. You know, raising in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. That's the King James Version. Are we there? We're almost there. We're not there? Okay, well, I can read it and they can find it. Ephesians 6, 4. Read it. You want me to read it for you? All right, verse 1 says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment of the promise. That's what we're doing because it's Father's Day. Here we go. Fathers, this is a specific verse, specifically lined out for fathers, right? Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the admonition of the Lord. So you have, I think there's three things that are specifically told to fathers to do. All right, ladies, you need to help your, let's go back to the outline now, Deborah, if you don't mind. Ladies, the best dads have a supportive wife who helped them to be good dads. All right? I'm going to go through these real quickly here. One more. There we go. Ephesians 4, 6, 4. Here's three things. Don't exasperate your kids. Don't provoke your children to wrath. Exasperates means to frustrate them. You can provoke your children by being too harsh. Provoke your children by not being there. Absentee fathers provoke their children. You can provoke your children by being indifferent to your children. Yeah. You know, I think sometimes in the simplest terms, you have good dads, you got bad dads, you got indifferent dads. Just don't care. If you don't care, I got a simple word for you. Repent. Repent. Repent of that sin. You owe your children good fatherhood there. So that's the first thing. Don't exasperate them. The second thing is bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, obviously, but bring them up. That speaks to hands-on parenting. In our culture, this is just my opinion. And once again, I may be wrong. I'm wrong often. Have y'all ever noticed how often I'm wrong? Okay, it helps me that you didn't say amen right there. Okay, but in our culture, most moms do the parenting. I think that's wrong. Bring them up. This is specifically an admonition to dads. Bring him up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. In the book of Proverbs, it was the dad who was telling the sons and daughters what to do. But if you follow it all the way through the Bible, both moms and dads do parenting. Sometimes the dad takes the lead, sometimes the mom takes the lead. I don't think it's completely true that in the Jewish culture, the dads did all of this. I think both of them did. Go back and look at the examples in Scripture. But what I want to say to you is, both is best. Both of us are supposed to bring them up. It's a part of your job, dads, to bring them on up. To be engaged enough to bring them on up. And I will say this too. It's not just your job to spank them when they're wrong. I mean, if you feel like that's the need, I mean, you need to pray about that. And if that's the need, do it. Don't worry about it. But at the same time, if you are nice to them and loving to them, loving, 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 loving 95% of the time, then spank them that other 5% of the time, that spanking would go a whole lot further. because they'll know that. So bring them up in the nurturing and admonition of the Lord. And then the third thing is the training and the instruction of the Lord. That's nurturing and admonition. That means you got to teach them right and wrong. Kids are not born knowing right and wrong. They have to be taught. You got to teach them what holiness is by example that you live, by the words that you say. You got to give your kids a good faith practices. And now what I mean is all the faith practices there. When your kids are going to learn how to handle problems by watching you. The way you handle them. If you just cuss, kick something, throw something, that's what they're going to do. Don't paddle them if they cuss and kick and throw something. If you've been doing the same thing. Jesus was taken to church from an early age. He was taken to church to be circumcised on the eighth day. He was taken to church at 12 years old. We know that from Scripture. Jesus knew the Scriptures. How did he know the Scriptures? Well, I think Mom and Dad must have taught him some things all along the way. Relationships, you teach your children about relationships. I've heard this a thousand times from women over the years. The men in our family don't know how to treat women. The men in our family don't know how to treat women. Well, whose fault is that? It's the dad's fault and the mom's fault. But we ought to teach them those kind of things. The importance of our faith, let's just figure this out. Let's see, which way we're going to lean? Football, faith. Football, faith. Football, faith. Which is most important? They can already tell who you root for. Can they tell who you believe in? Who's really there? Who's most important? First Baptist Church in Richland, several years ago, I pastored there for as long as they would have me. We had a problem. The men wouldn't bring their Bibles. And I thought that was just a small thing, but it just annoyed me. You ever get one of those things under your skin, kind of annoys you? And so I asked one of our deacons, I said, why don't the men in this church bring their Bibles to church? Because that's a silent witness, isn't it? That the Bible is important. It really speaks to the preacher. Is the preacher going to teach and preach where they need the Bible? But anyway, he said, well, I knew you'd have your Bible, and so I just didn't bring mine. I said, you never bring your Bible? He said, no. I said, do you have it? I got all carried away. His name is Neil. Probably did. And I'm as I stand here, I just know he went to heaven. But he just didn't take it seriously about bringing his Bible to church. And guess what? His kids weren't involved in church anywhere. It says that this is important to us. Our faith is translated or communicated in that way. I made no headway. It's the dad's job to teach his kids and mom's job to teach their kids responsibilities. And when it's necessary, we shouldn't be shy about disciplining our children as well. We need to be engaged in parenting. Here, don't exasperate them. That's the negative thing. Bring them up, hands-on kind of a thing. And third, here's teaching the instruction them about the Lord. Very little instruction, very little emphasis. So where is dad? Well, kind of quiet when it comes to dad. Most Southern Baptist churches are mostly women. You ever notice that? There's something about that that just ain't right, isn't it? So, I want to end on a positive note. I want to tell you about my granddad. My granddad beat my grandmother. Was an alcoholic. I don't know if the alcohol led to the beating, or the beating led to alcohol. But he beat my grandmother. He ran around on her for years. And the men of the community decided, that's enough. They got my grandfather. This is a true story. Not all the stories I tell are true. I lie sometimes from up here, okay? This is a true story. Took him out in the woods. The men got him, took him out in the woods, and beat the fool out of him. Amen? Does that communicate? Beat the fool out of him. And said, you're going to join the army. Sign up, go in the military, or this is going to be regular. We're going to come get you and do this on a regular basis. And he decided, he weighed his options, decided to join the military. Went off to the military, came back a changed person. He was a great husband to his wife after that, even though not the greatest, but better, much, much better. The beating stopped, the drinking stopped. Even though he took a little drink a little bit along, but most of that stopped. He focused on working. He was the hardest working person I ever met in my life. He taught me that fishing was a sin. It's not sin, but that's what he taught me. I'm just saying that. Now, here's the best part of this story. All that's true. I never knew that about my granddad until he died. The first half of his life was lived like that. The second half, I came along as a child, was born in the family. My dad took us down there to see him on a regular basis. The second half, I knew him as an exemplary dad, granddad, etc. Still remember him sitting on me on his tractor. Never could crank it up, but set me on the tractor. That's good enough for a kid sometimes, you know. So here's the point. I would have never known that had my dad not pulled me aside after my granddad was dead and said, "This is your dad, your granddad's good. This is your granddad. This is what was his life." So here's the this is what happened. Because he changed, I had a good granddad. And I'm saying to you, you can change. Through the power of God in the Holy Spirit, we can be better dads. We can be better moms. We can have a different kind of a family so that when our kids come along, they'll know. They'll know the difference. So that's my challenge. My challenge to you dads is to change. Change to be like Jesus. Not to be like all the dads you witnessed along the way, because they're probably not good enough. Change to be like Jesus. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do at my job? Yeah, that's important. What would Jesus do at the football field? Yeah, that's important. But more important than that, what would Jesus do in my own home? Do my kids see Jesus in me? And if they don't, you can change. Moms, if we ever need you on anything, we need you on this. Moms can help us to be better and better and better. And for the record, dad can also help moms to be better and better moms as well, right? It's a group thing. We're in the same boat of life. We can provoke each other to be better, but this is where I'm going to leave it. Change is possible. So here's what I want to suggest that you do. My challenge to you is to ask God what changes you need to make in your own life. Forget about your husband. Forget about your wife. Think about yourself. What changes can I make to make me look more like Jesus? Not to make me look more like another good father, but look like Jesus. And over time, he'll do that. Father, I pray you'd help us now. Give us the grace that we need to do what we need to do in this very, very, very crucial and important part of life. I ask, Father, that you would instruct us. Sometimes, God, we're slow to learn. We understand that. We're slow to hear and slow to learn. So we pray, God, that you grant us whatever it is that we need to push us along and bring us along. Help us to learn of you daily how to be good dads, good moms, good people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to have our invitation song now. We're not going to have people come to the front as usual in the Baptist church. We're going to make our decisions in the pew. I'm challenging you right now to pray that prayer we just prayed. Pray it on a regular basis and be serious about it. And the Lord will help you to change. And you'll turn up one day and look around. You'll be a different person.
Oh,
great. We have to depend on him, just like the children of Israel depended on God for the manna going across the wilderness. You've got to depend on God for his wisdom for this day. Let's go to him and ask his special blessings on us as we go forward. Donnie, good to have you back. Will you close us in prayer?
I'm our praise, Heavenly Father God, we thank you for this day, but we thank you for the blessing, God. We thank you for life, and you've been back. Ben, come to your house and worship. Father, we ask you a special prayer for those of us that are fathers, Lord, that you would help us, God, just open our eyes and our heart, God, that we may be other fathers. Lord, we just ask you to be with those today that were not able to.